So last night, Hawks and Bucks. It was interesting. In the intro, they were having these little sound bites of the Hawks players, right? And they asked Kevin Huerter about Trae Young. And he goes, at this point, he's our best player. I thought that was very telling because, one, I think it shows you how confident he is in himself. And I also think it means how loaded this young Hawks team with Cam Reddish, DeAndre Hunter. Now, to be fair, the reality of it is Trae Young is probably going to be their best player for the next 10 years, right? But just the mindset of a young Kevin Huerter and these other guys, I think they all believe in themselves and they all know how much talent they have. To be honest, when I turned on the game, I was shocked that there was no Trae Young. I really was. I thought he would give it a go. And, you know, Steph had a similar injury. I believe it was in Boston this year because when you wear those heavy ankle braces, what happens is when you turn the ankle over, the brace digs into the top of your foot and you actually hurt your foot, not your ankle. And it sounds like that's what's happened with Trae. And so the pain level, I guess, just was intolerable with the bruised foot. And so he was a no-go. Well, the game starts and you saw a full Ewing effect at play. The Hawks start the game 10-2. And you know what, man? To me, and this is not the greatest time to bring this up, given off what happened last night, but the Bucks are innately soft. That's the nature of the Bucks. And you've seen it over and over again. When forced, they can come out like beasts, right? When their hand is forced for a game or two, elimination time, they can look like beasts. But it has to be forced. Their baseline, their nature is not tough. And maybe soft is strong, but it ain't tough, right? It's somewhere in between. And for instance, last year's Lakers, they were just naturally dogs. They'd come out on a Tuesday night in Orlando and bully the fuck out of the Magic just for no reason, just because that was their baseline. And you really like to see that when it comes to championship teams. I'd probably say the same thing about this Nets team this year when they were healthy, right? They'd come out and just roll a team for no reason. That was their baseline. And it really is the role players that really help define that trait in a team. Of course, you're going to pay attention to the stars and who they are. They set the tone. But the role players, the guys that fill it in, really set that trait in a team and define that trait, in my opinion. And you saw it again with the Lakers and Caruso and KCP and Dwight and how they did that, right? And I think the Bucks knew this. Look at who they added to their roster this year. Bobby Portis, PJ. They were trying to add Bogdanovich. Rough Riders, dudes that would bring that mentality night in and night out. It still feels like this team isn't that. But I'll tell you what, man, this game was far more exciting than I thought it was, despite the unfortunate events, just because I was like, Chris Dunn. I didn't even know he was still in the league. Nate McMillan brings out Chris Dunn. And then how about Cam Reddish just bawling? Cam Reddish was dogging the fuck out of Chris Middleton. I knew he was going to be nice, man. I knew he was going to be nice coming out of Duke. That was just such a good draft for the Hawks and Travis Schlenk when they pulled that out. Because now I'm forgetting. I probably don't want to mess this up and say this, but I feel like they gave New Orleans Jackson Hayes, and then they got Cam. I don't know how they did it, man, but Cam Reddish had a huge impact on that game, and he looks like a problem for Chris Middleton. He really does. His length, his athleticism, and it looks like he's buying into being a defensive stopper, a real 3-and-D wing. You saw Okongwu continuing to ball. There was a nice little move he made where he hit a jump stop and then he pivoted off to the left and finished. And it was just real simple. You wouldn't really think about it, but in today's game, not a lot of big men have that fundamentals to go to their weak side like that and pivot off their right foot and finish with the left hand. Most young bigs are going to catch that ball and just try to elevate and use their athleticism. And so Okongwu is fundamentally sound, very strong. And, you know, this Hawks team, man, they came out and I think there was also a little bit of a letdown from the Bucks, where when it was announced Trae wasn't going, they innately let their guard down. And then, of course, it happens. Giannis goes down, the knee buckles. How tough is Giannis? How tough is Giannis, man? If that was LeBron, they would have opened up the top of the arena for a chopper to come down and airlift him out of there. No, not the time to joke. But he, you know, just the fact that he got up and the way he dealt with it, and it was almost silly to an extent where he didn't want help from his brother. And then the Bucks, I've been talking about it all series long, these little indicators that the organization isn't as buttoned up or as intelligent as they need to be. Somehow they let Giannis wander back to the bench? Yeah, man. I don't know. As of right now, I don't know the official news on it. It sounds like they think it's an ACL. And now the conversation is intensified about this condensed season and all the injuries. Look, I agree they're playing too many games. I have to cover it. I've been swamped and exhausted from how these games are stacked up on each other. I understand that, but I'm not so sure we can blame these injuries on it. The soft tissue ones, sure, right? Harden's hamstring. Cam Reddish was out with Achilles soreness, right? But Trey stepped on a foot. Kyrie, the same thing. Giannis's injury was freaky. AD's was freaky, was a big collision. What I think it is the way the game is being played in so much space. It's the three ball. It's the distance that players are having to close out and recover from in the three ball era. You look at someone like Anthony Davis or Giannis, they've got to close out to the three-point line, turn around, come flying in for a rebound to protect the rim. And that momentum and that space, that distance that's covered with these leapers, I don't know. I don't think that we can fully blame that. But that being said, the NBA's got to chill. You've got the Summer Olympics, and now they're talking about a mid-season tournament? I don't know, man. So look, I'm not totally dismissing the fact that they're playing all these games. There's an element of it. But a lot of the injuries to these stars, I don't know if you can point to that because they were things that are unavoidable. Collisions, dangerous plays. I hate to see it, man. But I'll say this. I think that it could ultimately end up being a blessing in disguise for Giannis to have a season off where he can get his release right and then perhaps develop a post move. It's going to slow him down for 6 months to a year where he's going to have to focus on the details and the fundamentals. Because I think we know enough about Giannis. We don't have to worry about his mental recovery, right? He's going to come back being Giannis. He's not going to lose confidence in himself. And so ultimately it could help him. Prayers out to Big G though. You know, he is built different literally and figuratively. So maybe it's just a hyperextension and a bone bruise. Either way, you don't expect to see him the rest of these playoffs. Tonight, game 6 in Los Angeles, Suns Clippers. I expect the Suns to come out and establish DeAndre Ayton early and often. I think they're going to try to get Marcus Morris off the floor. Some deep post catches get him in foul trouble. And then once he's off the floor, if Ty Lue's going to go to Boogie, then they'll start to cook him in the pick and roll. You'll see CP and Booker get loose coming downhill. The other thing that I think we need to keep our eye on is, as great as Paul George has been, much like Durant in that Bucks series, I think the legs are starting to go, right? He's leading the playoffs in minutes. And I think you saw it in the fourth quarter of that game 5 where he was getting it done, but he was looking wobbly. I don't know how much juice he has left in those legs to close out this series. So I expect the Suns to actually get it done here on the road in game 6 and advance to their first finals since, what, the 93 season? This is the Hezi, brought to you by BasketballGods.net. I'm out, y'all.